Hello, my beloved dummies. How are you feeling? Still aspiring to become great programmers? Well, then remember a very important point. A true programmer should always go to bed at 8:20 p.m. or 2:30 a.m. Well, at the very latest, 5:10 a.m. and wake up at 10:24 a.m. or at the very latest, 8:40 a.m. So, we need to create a test scene so that we can focus on experimenting without cluttering the main scene with unnecessary materials, objects, and logic branches. Click the copy icon and select new. Let's name the new scene, test scene. Create a plane. Rename it to test BG. Scale it up by a factor of 10. Press S, then 10, then enter. Apply the scale. Add a material. Rename the material to test BG. Instead of color, choose a checker texture. Increase the texture scale to 10. Create a cube. Raise it exactly 1 meter so that it sits on our plane. You can press G, Z, 1, enter. Rename it to test target. Switch to the top view. Copy the cube 3 times and place the copies around our central cube. It's advisable to do this with snapping to the grid to avoid having too many decimal places in the coordinates. Create a material for the central cube. Name it test player. Choose green color. Now, let's slightly modify the shape of the green cube. Switch to edit mode, then to face select mode, either by clicking the icon or by pressing 3. Select the front face, then perform an inset with the I key. Drag the resulting face forward. Just a reminder, forward corresponds to the positive y-axis. Now, our player has an arrow shape, and we'll be able to see which way it's facing. Now, let's move on to the cubes around it. Rename them to test target 1, 2, and 3. Select one of them. Create a new material and name it test target. Choose blue color. Select all three cubes with the blue one last and press Ctrl L. In the menu that appears, select materials. Now, all the cubes are blue. Now, add a camera. Raise it upwards strictly along the Z-axis. Reset its rotation by pressing Alt R. Now the camera is looking down. Rename it to Test Camera. Open the Output Properties panel and make the viewport size square. You can simply copy the lower value, 1080, and paste it into the upper field. Now, switch to the Animation tab. In the left window, press Numpad 0 to switch to the camera view. In the right window, grab the camera by its gizmo and move it along the Z-axis to the desired distance so that our entire scene fits in the camera view. If we run our game now, we'll see a completely black screen. That's because there's no lighting in our test scene. One last thing, go to the World Properties panel and create a new material for the world. Name it Test World. For clarity, switch to the Render Preview. Adjust the strength value. 10 should be sufficient for normal lighting. Excellent. We have the groundwork and now let's experiment. We need to create a new logic branch. Click the cross to close the current one. It won't disappear. You can reopen it from the library by clicking the button and selecting it from the list. Click the new button. Name the new branch, test target. Open the transform section and select the set object rotation block. Let's try to understand how it works. The first thing we need to do is simplify communication with this block. Because people usually don't know what Euler, quaternion, and radian mean, and at this stage of your development, I'm unlikely to be able to explain how to rotate an object using quaternions. Just click on the first drop-down list and choose Axis Angle. This means we'll be rotating our object around a selected axis by a specified angle. In the second drop-down list, let's steer clear of radians and go for regular degrees. Open the list and select degrees. This means we'll be specifying the angle in familiar values. I hope everyone remembers that there are 360 degrees in a circle. It doesn't matter where the degree measure starts. We don't care where zero is located. The key thing to understand is that positive values go counterclockwise. So, if we want to rotate an object to the left by 45 degrees, we should set it to 45 degrees. For clarity, let's add a keyboard sensor. Set the sensor to start mode triggering. Now let's copy both blocks, change the key to the right arrow, and rotate the object by minus 45 degrees. Now let's attach this logic branch to our object and run the game. Try pressing the keys. What? Nothing is happening. Of course, it's not working. Let me explain what's wrong. Close the game and go back to the nodes. Look here. If all the axes have zeros, it means the specified angle isn't applied to any axis. To rotate our object, we must select an axis and change the value to something else. It doesn't matter what. Let's set it to 1. We just need to decide on the axis. If we're going to rotate the object like this, then we definitely need the z-axis. Enter 1 here and here. Now, let's run the game again. Try pressing the arrow keys. Now our object rotates in two directions. Some might find it strange that pressing the same button again doesn't change anything. This happens because the set object rotation block uses absolute values. And pressing the left arrow key rotates our object in that direction. If we press the key again, we won't add anything to the existing direction. We'll simply rotate the object in the same direction again. We've covered the basics. Now, let's learn how to rotate an object towards another object. For example, let's make our green cube rotate towards one of the three blue targets of our choice. We won't delete these blocks, they won't get in our way. Let's copy one of the connections, replace the key with the number 1. And now we need magic. In other words, we need another block. It's in the same transform section and is called lookAt. This block needs to be fed to vector values. The first is the location of our green cube because the direction will be calculated from it. And the second vector is the location of the target. In simpler terms, we need to mark 2 points, and this block will return the required rotation angle in the rotation format, and we'll pass this angle to the set object rotation block. Let's do it. Connect the rotation output to the rotation input. Now, for the sake of completeness, let's do everything as straightforward and inefficient as possible. Select the green cube and open right panel with N key. In the right panel, on the item tab, we can view the coordinates of the selected object. Right now, we need to remember them and enter them in the lookAt block in the first section, which is called from. Enter 0, 0, 1 here. Now, select target number 1. Enter its coordinates in the second section. And the last option, we need to choose the axis that will be used as the pointing finger, nose, or front, no matter what you call it. Basically, this axis will determine the direction in which our object will look forward. We certainly need a positive Y. Now, run the game. Press the number 1 key. Our green cube will now rotate precisely toward target number 1. Now, quickly go back to the nodes. Copy this connection twice. Change the keys to 2 and 3. Enter the coordinates for the second and third targets. The coordinates for from remain the same in all blocks. They are the coordinates of the green cube. Run the game and check all three keys. The green now rotates in three directions of your choosing. Hooray! Now imagine this situation. What if your goals move? How can we get the green one to look towards a target whose coordinates are constantly changing? Try going back to the scene and moving a couple of targets to new places. Launch the game again. What's going on? Green continues to turn to old positions. Because our code specifies fixed values that have nothing to do with the new position of the targets. Let's fix this problem. We need a new block. Everything is from the same transform section. It's called getObjectLocation. This block returns the coordinates of the selected object in vector format. We need two such blocks. In the first one, you can leave the object field empty because we need the coordinates of our green one, and this logical branch is attached specifically to it. We connect this block to the fromLocation input. In the second block, we indicate target number 1 with a picker and connect the block to the toLocation input. In the other two links, we indicate goals number 2 and 3. Let's launch the game and check how everything works. It seems like nothing has changed. Everything works just like before. But if we go back to our scene and move the targets to new positions, our scheme won't break. The green cube will look precisely in the direction of our targets, regardless of their position. For complete happiness and optimization, you can delete two identical blocks and connect one to all three inputs. Want another visual example? Of course, you do. Let's move to targets somewhere down and place the first one in the upper left corner. From the event section, take an update block. Next, from the transform section, take a translate object block. Connect them. Let's move our target number 1 to the right at a speed of 100 per tick. Don't forget to select target number 1 in the object field. Run the game. Our target is slowly moving to the right on the screen. And pressing the number 1 key each time rotates our green cube toward the moving target. Isn't that wonderful? One last option. Remove the block with the number 1 key and connect a cable from the update block instead. Run the game again. Now, our green cube smoothly follows the target in real time. Well, let's stop here for now. Until the fuses blow. In the next lesson, I promise it will get hot again. Because we'll need to rotate an object towards the mouse cursor. And that's quite a challenge. See you soon. Goodbye for now.